Yeah. You ready? Hey. Let's go. Bet.
Something with this kid, and I go out there, and he's like traumatized. Like he looks like he just saw like a ghost or something. I'm like, dude, what's your deal? And he's like, everyone in there. He's like, they're raising their hands. I'm like, yeah, it's what you do in worship. And he's like, no, you don't do that. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, in Germany, he's like, you can never raise your hands because like, you know, like Hail Hitler, like that kind of thing. Like they're taught in Germany, like under no circumstances can you raise your hands. So that was a whole thing. I tried to like explain it to him, but he didn't speak like that great of English. And it was kind of just like agree to disagree. But after he had been there for like a month or so, I saw him like raise his hands. And if you guys have ever seen someone raise their hands for the first time, they look all awkward. So he kind of like looks around and he's like, you know, like looking around. And so anyways, I tell that story because tonight what we're going to be talking about is the power of lifting your hands in worship. All right. This is something that you probably have not heard a sermon on in church. Maybe you have. And if you have, that's great. But my guess would be that you probably have not heard a message on this. But I felt that God put this on my heart to preach. And the reason why is because, you know, sometimes, in fact, I'd venture to say most of the time when a new person comes into a church, you know, and maybe they, you know, they've never seen it before, they're probably a little confused as to why everyone's raising their hands, you know, and maybe even you've been coming to a church like this for a long time and you still don't really understand the reason why you raise your hands in worship. I mean, how many, just being honest, and I've even done this, how many of you guys have wondered, like, why do we raise our hands in worship? All right, you're not going to be judged. All right, so we have a couple people. All right, the rest of you guys, I guess I don't need to preach. You guys can come up here and preach and explain it. No, I'm just playing. But it's the reality is it's something that people, especially if they haven't grown up in church, they don't know why. And if you don't understand why you raise your hands in worship, then you can look at it as something that's either just cultural, it's just a cultural thing in a youth group, or you can look at it as spiritual exercise or spiritual calisthenics. And it's neither of those things. You know, what we do physically has a spiritual effect, and what we do spiritually has a physical effect. And we're going to be reading out of Exodus chapter 17 tonight. It's a really, really interesting story. Pick it up in verse 8. It says this. It says, the Amalekites, say Amalekites. The Amalekites came and attacked the Israelites at Rephidim. Say Rephidim. Good job. Moses said to Joshua, choose some of our men and go out to fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow, I will stand on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands. So Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. You know, this is a very interesting story to read. I want you guys to focus on that last sentence. It says, as long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. You know, so although Joshua has chosen the fighting men, and you have to assume he chose the best, right? And even though they were following God's orders, you know, God literally gave them the order to go attack the Amalekites. So what this is saying is they're not going out on their own will. They're not operating outside the will of God. You know, they're not doing it without praying or asking God. This is them following the leading of the Lord, you know, that God's will for their life. And even though they have the presence of God so visibly with them, if you guys remember our series Led by Fire, God's presence is so clearly with them that they literally have a pillar of fire by night and cloud by day. And even though they're eating manna, unless Moses lifts up his hands, the Amalekites win. Isn't that interesting? You know, see, I think Christians make a mistake a lot of times by having the thought or maybe saying, if it's God's will, it's just going to happen. But the reality is, students, that is not the case. That is not true. God's will is not always done. And now maybe you're like, what? What did Pastor Peyton just say? God's will isn't always done? Yeah, I don't have this up on the screen. I added this late, but 2 Peter 3:9, it says, "He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief." So God's will is that no one would perish, but people still die, do they not? You know, there are things that are in the will of God that unless you and I cooperate with him and do what he's asking us to do, we will never see them. So what kind of battle is this that the Israelites are fighting with the Amalekites? You know, on the surface, it looks physical, but obviously there's a lot more going on here than just a physical battle. There is a spiritual component that determines the physical realm. You know, if Moses lifts up his hands, they win. And if he lowers his hands, they lose. The Amalekites win. So this is telling us something, that the key to life's battles is found in what you and I do supernaturally. And how many of you guys know we live in a supernatural world? You know what I'm talking about? We live in a supernatural world. It says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, it says, "For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, against evil spirits in the heavenly places." So we're fighting a spiritual battle, guys. I need you guys to understand that there is way more that is going on behind the scenes that we can't see. Now we're going to continue on in the story. It says in verse 12 through 13, it says, "When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side and one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword." You know, I love that it says that his friends, you know, his arms were too tired, and his friends stood on either side of him and held his arms up. What is that telling us? To me, that tells me that sometimes you got to have some friends that are going to help us praise the Lord. You know what I'm saying? You know, sometimes we need people to say, people in our life, our close friends, to say, you know, you ought to raise your hands. You know, you're in a battle right now. You should lift your hands while you're in worship. You know, let me come alongside you. Let me help with you. Let me worship with you. Let me help you worship. Let me help you pray. You guys need someone. You need to surround yourself by people who are going to help you lift your hands as they lift yours and just encouraging you. And it says, "So that his hands remained steady till sunset. So Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword." So here's what's interesting. They hold his hands up. His hands remain steady. So on the surface, it looks like Joshua just had the better army, right? You know, unless you were there with them, unless you were there witnessing that, on the surface, it looks like Joshua just had the better army, and that's the reason why they won the battle. You know, Joshua was the better commander. But no, what God is telling us is that what Moses did with the help of Aaron and Hur determined what happened with the armies of Israel. You know, raised hands in a battle bring victory. I want you guys to remember that. I want you to turn to your neighbor actually and say that. Say, "Raised hands in a battle bring victory." All right, turn to your other neighbor and say it, because I saw some of you guys trying to decide which one to say it to. "Raised hands in a battle bring victory." Listen, if there's like one thing that you guys remember from tonight, I want you guys to remember that. Raised hands in a battle bring victory. All right? That's the message here that we look at. So moving on into verse 14, it says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered." All right, that is not a coincidence. God specifically said, he said, "Hey, this thing that just happened, make sure you write it down so it's remembered." All right, and God is very intentional by saying that. And then he says, "And make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Amalek from under heaven." Moses built an altar and called it, "The Lord is my banner." He said, "Because hands were lifted up to the throne of God, the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation." So again, he said, as something to be remembered. Guys, this is something, when that's in the Bible, guys, this is something that God is like, hey, pay attention. Make sure you remember this. Make sure you make note of this. Make sure you apply this to your life. You know, If they didn't write this down, then we wouldn't be reading it today. It was very important that they wrote this down and it was remembered. And it says, "Hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord." And the result was that there was a victory. You know, when you and I, guys, when we lift our hands up to God, when we're spending time in prayer, when we're spending time in worship, and we're lifting our hands up to God, there is a battle that is being fought in the spiritual realm around us. And when we raise our hands, it brings victory. You know, if you want to win the battle, if you want to see God go before you, then lift your hands and bless the Lord and watch what God will do. If you have a battle in your life, if you're going through something right now, you're going through something in the future, lift your hands and bless the Lord and watch what God will do on your behalf. Listen, this is important. Some of you came in here today and you're facing a battle in your life. You're facing a battle with depression. You came in here and you're fighting a battle with some sort of addiction. You came in here and you're fighting a battle back at home with a relationship with your parents, or you're fighting a battle with a toxic relationship, or you're fighting a battle at school. Whatever it may be, you came in here fighting a battle. And this is the perfect place for you to lift up your hands and say, God, I'm lifting up my hands to you. God, you know my situation. God, I need you to fight this battle on my behalf. God, I need you to go before me. God, I need you to bring a victory because I can't do this on my own. I know the only way that I'm going to receive a victory right now is by lifting my hands and inviting you into my situation, lifting my hands and asking you to fight this battle on my behalf. You know, and I know that as I'm lifting my hands, I'm winning the battle because I know that you're at work on my behalf. You know, and let me just share a principle with you. When God is leading you to a place, you will go to a place spiritually before you experience it physically. When God is speaking to you, when you're going through a situation, when you're in a battle, you know, you may be in a situation where it looks hopeless. You may be in a situation where you can't see how God's going to bring a victory out of it. But by you going there first spiritually, by you lifting your hands and saying, God, I need to see a victory. God, I need you to go before me. God, I'm surrendering this situation to you. You're going to go to a place spiritually before you experience it physically. That's the lesson of Exodus chapter 17. And now listen, guys, you might be sitting there, you're like, okay, cool, that's just one story in the Bible. That's the reason why we raise our hands when we worship. No, guys, this is all throughout the Bible. In fact, this isn't even the only story about Moses in the Bible about the importance of lifting hands. If you jump over to Exodus chapter 9, it says, Moses replied, when I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands in prayer to the Lord. The thunder will stop and there will be no more hail, so you may know that the earth is the Lord's. So why is Moses lifting his hands here? It's because there's a power when you and I pray and we lift our hands. Guys, it's all over the Bible. So if we want to do what God's asking us to do, then we have to lift our hands when we're praying and worshiping. You know, and I'm not saying it's the only tool in the toolbox, guys, but it's a very important one. You know, and some of you may have said in your head, you know, I just don't want to do that. You know, I don't want to do that. I don't feel comfortable doing that. And what you've done is, by you saying that, by you having that mindset, you know, I don't really feel like lifting my hands. You know, it makes me uncomfortable. What is someone next to me going to think? What you're doing by saying that and thinking that is you're saying, I'd rather go into battle with a butter knife than I would with a sword. Every time you make the decision, you're like, I'm just gonna go into service and, you know, I'm not really gonna engage in worship. I'm just gonna kind of stand in the back. I'm gonna keep my hands in my pockets. What you're saying is, I don't need God. And I'd rather fight this battle that I'm going through. And don't fool yourself. There's no one in here who's not fighting a battle of some sort. You're saying, I'd rather go into a battle with a butter knife than a sword. That's what you're saying. You're saying, I know better than God. I don't need God. I'm good enough on my own. I mean, wouldn't it be silly? I mean, think of like some epic battle from a movie. Think of like Lord of the Rings. Can you imagine if Aragorn, right? You know, like one of the best main characters ever. Can you imagine if he was storming Helm's Deep and he didn't have a sword? He's like, yeah, I'm gonna go fight with my bare hands. You'd be like, what? What are you doing? Why would you not grab a sword? And that's exactly what we're doing when we're choosing to not follow what the Bible says. You're hurting yourself because you don't understand. And it's so easy to say, well, I wasn't raised that way. That wasn't the way that the church was that I grew up in. Or my parents don't do that. I mean, that means nothing. Who cares how you were raised? Who cares how you feel? Who cares how, you know, what your comfort is? It's not about that. It's about what the Bible says. You know, ultimately, that's what the issue is. You know, are you going to do the Bible thing, or are you going to do your cultural thing? Are you going to do what you're comfortable with? You know, and if you choose comfort over doing the Word of God, then you're going to forfeit much of what could have been yours. Guys, that's the reality. It says in Exodus chapter 9, verse 33, jumping forward, it says, Moses left Pharaoh and went out of the city. It says, he spread out his hands toward the Lord. The thunder and hail stopped. What was that saying? It's saying he stretched out his hands, and then powerful things happened when Moses lifted his hands. It's all over the Bible, guys. We can see it in Chronicles. Jumping over to 2 Chronicles, it says, then Solomon knelt on his knees in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands toward heaven and said, O Lord, God of Israel. You say, why is this significant? It's because there is a power that attends it. There is a power that attends when you lift your hands to God. He lifts his hands and watch what happens. Jumping forward into chapter 7, verse 1, it says, as soon as Solomon finished his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Now, I'm not saying every time you guys lift your hands, God's just going to shoot down fire and burn up something near you. You know, I'm not saying that's going to happen, all right? That's something that God certainly can do. That's not something that's going to happen every time. But I want you guys to notice it says, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. We see it in Ezra chapter 9. It says, then at the evening sacrifice, I rose from my self-abasement with my tunic and cloak torn and fell on my knees with my hands spread out to the Lord my God. Now, maybe you're sitting there and you're thinking, oh, but these are all Old Testament. You know, that doesn't apply. It's all Old Testament. All right, well, let's jump to New Testament. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8. Paul says, I want the men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer without anger or disputing. You know, how many of you guys have ever gotten annoyed by something that a pastor was preaching? Just be honest. You're not going to hurt my feelings. How many of you guys have ever gotten annoyed by something that a pastor was preaching? Yeah. Thanks, Pastor Logan. You know, like one of those things where it's like, dude, stop telling me what to do. That's making me uncomfortable. Stop telling me to give money to mission. Stop telling me to get out of that toxic relationship with that boyfriend or girlfriend. You know, stop telling me that I need to pray daily. Stop telling me that I need to forgive people. You know, and I would just say that if the pastor says something like that and it makes you mad, it's probably because they're setting off an area in your life that actually needs change. So if you're sitting out there thinking, you know, I wish he would just stop telling me to raise my hands. I've already made up my mind. I'm uncomfortable. If you're getting upset about this, then maybe it's setting off an area in your life that actually needs change. You know, and I love that Paul says this. Paul is so relatable. He says, without anger or disputing. What does that mean? You know, that means without getting mad, because you could be sitting there thinking, oh, there goes Pastor Peyton telling me to raise my hands again. You know, oh, there goes the worship leader telling me to raise my hands. You know, don't get mad is what Paul's saying. Don't dispute. Don't think things like, man, I don't know why they always have to say that. Man, I don't know why when Tanner or when Kirsten or when whoever on Sunday morning is like, all right, church, let's lift our hands. Man, I wish they would just shut up. I wish they would just stop saying that. Paul knows, the Holy Spirit knows, and that's the reason why it says without anger or disputing. He says, do it. We lift our hands because as we lift our hands, we're preparing the way for a victory in our life. Guys, I know I'm repeating myself, but it's because this is so important, all right? This is like battle training, all right? This is like me telling you guys what God's recipe is, how God says you're supposed to fight your battles. You see it in the Psalms. I've got three verses up here, back to back. It says in Psalm 63, it says, I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. Psalm 88, it says, each day I beg for your help, O Lord. I lift my hands to you for mercy. You know, and I would just say there's something about lifting your hands to God, you know, petitioning yourself to God that brings about an answer to God. And sometimes, I think the Bible makes this clear. Sometimes I think that answer is only brought about because you lift your hands. You know, that answer wouldn't come about. That victory wouldn't be brought forth any other way than you lifting your hands. It says in Psalm 134, it says, lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. Now listen, this is a command, all right? This is not a suggestion. So this is something where it's almost like I don't understand how people could not do it when they're in church, how people could not do it when they're worshiping and praying. You know, this is literally a command. It's not a suggestion. You know, it's a command from the heart of God. And it's not just an act of worship, it's actually a means to victory. And what my heart is in preaching this sermon, I would hate for any single one of you guys to forfeit a victory that would have been yours, but you don't receive that victory because you choose to be so stubborn that you won't raise your hands. That's my heart behind this. I want you guys to hear what I'm saying. I'm not coming up here to just try and keep on repeating this so that way we can have more people raise hands so it looks cool. No, guys, my heart behind this is I don't want to see any of you guys not receive a victory in your life, not receive a victory in some sort of battle that you're walking through because either you don't know, you've never heard it before, or because you're too prideful, or because it makes you uncomfortable, or whatever it may be. That's my heart behind this. You know, so I don't want you to hurt yourself when you don't embrace the Word of God. You know, and I haven't given you every single scripture in the Bible about lifting hands in prayer and worship. If I did, I'd be up here for hours. But, you know, and maybe you're sitting there and you're like, well, I never heard this growing up. This is something that I've never had explained to me. That's neither here nor there. You've heard it now. And this is an opportunity for you to step out and see what God will do. And I would just tell you through my experience through the years that maybe someone who's never tried raising their hands in worship, you know, it's true. It can be a little bit uncomfortable at times. And, you know, if you've been around church long enough, you know what I'm talking about. Usually the place that they start is kind of just like down here, you know, elbow by the hip, hands up, and that's comfortable. And then before long, you know, you do one of these, you're like, all right, my hands aren't going to be above my head, but I'm going to raise them. And then before long, your hands are up, and, you know, that's great. And, you know, and I just want to encourage you, when you do that, you're going to experience the presence of the Lord in a new way. Because anytime we honor the Lord, God honors that act of faith by letting us sense His presence in a new way. So I want to encourage you with that. That when God sees you doing that, even if it makes you uncomfortable, like, God, like, I'm nervous about doing this. I think it's a little weird, but I'm going to do it. When God sees you do that, He honors that act of faith, and you're going to experience His presence in a new way. Watch what God will do. All right, here we go. We're wrapping up. And I want you guys to see, so we don't forget the point of the story, I want to jump back to Exodus chapter 17 really quick. It says in verse 16, it says, He said, "For hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation." Do you guys see that? Do you guys see what happens at the end of it? It says, "For hands were lifted up to the throne of the Lord. The Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation." You know, and maybe you've never thought about it this way, but what you and I do today, the effects of that last a lot longer than just today. It says from generation to generation. You know, it's such a clear thing here. It says because hands were lifted. You know, Moses' arms were tired, but he said, "I'm going to keep my hands lifted because I can see the results." God let him see that so that you and I can know that it's powerful when we lift our hands. You know, Moses is saying, because I lifted my hands today, there's going to be victories tomorrow, and there's going to be victories the next week, and there's going to be victories the next month, and there's going to be victories for years to come. Guys, the way that we worship tonight, I want you guys to really hear me on this. The way that we worship on Wednesday nights, the way that you guys worship tonight, there's going to be ripple effects that happen in the weeks to come, in the months to come, in the years to come. And this is not just like this is the only story in the Bible that says this. Guys, the way that we live our lives, the way that we encounter the presence of the Lord, the way that we worship, the way that we pray, even though it's great in the moment, even though it's powerful in the moment, even though God can move and do a mighty thing in that moment, it does so much more than just in that moment. You know, and I just want you guys to really hear me out on this. Guys, I want to create a legacy here at New Hope Youth. Like, I want this to be a youth group that people talk about as that's a youth group that really knows how to pray. That's a youth group that really knows how to worship. Guys, when there's younger kids that are coming up here in the years to come, I want them to be able to look to you guys and say, that's what it looks like to go after God. That's what it looks like to pray for your friends. That's what it looks like to really worship. You guys with me? All right, I'm going to invite you guys to stand up on your feet. I'm going to invite the worship team on up because you guys are going to have an opportunity to do that very thing right now. You know, I don't know what you guys came in here with tonight, but the reality is every single one of us is fighting a battle. Every single one of us has a situation, whether it's a situation with a friend, whether it's a situation with maybe a parent, a family member, whether it's a situation at school, every single one of us is dealing with something. And I tried to leave ample time at the end of the night because I want to give you guys the chance to practice what you just heard. And I'm not doing this. I'm not telling you this just so that way it looks cool that everyone in the room is raising their hands. Guys, I'm doing this because I want you guys to experience the fullness of what God has for your life. I mean that. And maybe you're in this room and you've never raised your hands before, and you're still kind of uncertain about this thing. You know, you're like, oh man, I don't know. Just try it. Give God a chance. And maybe you're in this room and you know one of your friends is going through a situation. Maybe you've got a friend in here who's in the middle of a battle right now, and you know, and they know, but maybe no one else knows. And you got to be like his friends. And you got to stand beside them. And you got to pray and worship with them. You know, maybe you don't need to physically hold up their hands, but you got to be a good friend and help them win that battle, to petition the Lord for them. So that's exactly what we're going to do right now. We're about to enter into a time of worship and prayer. And we're going to worship God the way that he deserves to be worshiped. We're going to worship God the way the Bible says that he should be worshiped. Can we do that? Can we do that, New Hope Youth? All right.